Hey, welcome back. What I want to do now in this session is to lay a conceptual foundation, or a principle, if you will, upon which our strategy for personal evangelism is built. So in our next session, I'm going to teach you the four-step witnessing strategy that I've been talking about, but it will make so much more sense to you then if you first catch a vision for this kingdom principle that I'm going to share with you now in this session. You will remember that research by Peel and Larimore that I quoted earlier that showed that 75 to 90% of Christians get saved through an ongoing interaction with a Christian friend or family member. Now, I want us to bear that in mind as we read a portion of scripture from John chapter 1, because in these verses, we're going to see a certain approach consistently being used to bring people to Jesus. And the interesting thing is that the perfectly mature used this approach. In other words, Jesus himself used it, and complete novices used it as well. It works for everyone. So the beauty of it is that it's inoffensive, it requires no special skill or being able to teach anything, and everyone can do it, and yet it is incredibly effective. So let's read together John chapter 1, and we will start in verse 35. The next day, again, John the Baptist was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. Jesus turned and saw them following, and he said to them, "What are you seeking?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come, and you will see." And so they came and saw where he was staying, and they stayed with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. One of the two who heard John speak and followed Jesus was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his own brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which means Christ or anointed one. He brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You shall be called Cephas," which means Peter. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Come and see. Now notice this similar witnessing pattern used by Jesus himself, and then by Andrew, and then by Philip. So Jesus began this whole domino effect of people witnessing to each other by asking Andrew and the other disciple, probably John himself, the author of this gospel, and he asked Andrew a very simple and yet profound question. What are you seeking? And we can all in some way ask the same question of our friends when the moment presents itself. We can take up something which we see them doing, a place they're going, a book they're reading, and just ask them, "Why are you reading that? Why are you doing that? What are you seeking?" And when Andrew and his friend said to Jesus, "Teacher, Rabbi, where are you staying?" He simply said to them, "Come and you'll see." He didn't give them a lecture. He didn't try to teach them anything at that moment, although you and I both know he had much to say and he had much to teach these men. And yet, he simply invited them to come along and see for themselves. And notice what happened when they did. They got a whole lot more than they initially expected. So these two guys ended up staying with Jesus for the whole day. You know, sometimes all that is required is for someone just to be invited to come and see. And then once they're there, they find that there is something more to this than they were expecting. And they linger a little bit and they meet other people and they start to learn and they start becoming more comfortable. So the next thing that you will see, and this happens to people who are now coming and seeing and starting to feel more comfortable, is they begin to invite others to come and see too. And that's what we see happen now. It was Andrew himself then who took exactly the same approach, and he did it with Simon Peter, his brother. He made a very short statement about what he believed to be true. "We found the Messiah," he says, but then instead of trying to convince his brother of the truth of all this and why he believes it and argue the point with him, he simply brought him to Jesus to come and see for himself. And immediately, what happens? Jesus began interacting with Peter. Which is what we want, isn't it? This is a wonderful approach. We've met the Messiah. Come and see. Come and see. Jesus then approached Philip, and he simply said to Philip, "Follow me." And that's essentially the same invitation. It's not a long lecture. It's not a theological discourse. It is simply, come along with me and see and hear for yourself. Now, I am of course not saying that teaching and preaching the truths of the gospel are not necessary, and obviously you already know that I do not believe that. What I am saying is that a powerful approach to that initial interaction when we are witnessing to an unbeliever is to avoid a long lecture or trying to convince the person of the truth, but rather to invite them to come along to something and to see for themselves. And so Jesus simply said to Philip, "Come, follow me." And then Philip, in turn, did the same with Nathanael. He made a very short statement about what he believed to be true. And when Nathanael was skeptical, you know, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Philip didn't try to argue the point. He just invited Nathanael to come with him and see for himself. "Come and see," he said. "Come and see." Now, if you are curious about the point that I'm making, but you're still wondering practically in your own life, what does this look like, you know, for us? What we're going to look at in the next session is a four-step witnessing plan for winsomely and intelligently engaging the unsaved people in our lives with the gospel. But I'm covering this as a general principle in this session because this principle is at the heart of the four-step strategy. Okay, so one last thing we need to do on this video. Before we get into that next session, there is now a job which I want you to do. I'm going to tell you a little story now around some guys I've been witnessing to and how I got myself into this situation, because that's going to lead to this little job you've got to do at the end of this session before we begin our next video. A few years ago, I had been on holiday with my family, and at the place we were at holiday, there were a couple of other families from my daughter's school at the same place, two other families. And we got to spend a little bit of time with these families, and I got to spend time with the two dads. And when we got back to Cape Town, it was several months later that I was then invited to a school function with my daughter. It was like a master chef thing where we would cook something together. And during the social time before the cooking began, all the dads were milling around, and I saw these two guys that we'd been on holiday with standing chatting together. So I walked up to them and I said, "Hey guys, how's it going?" And then I addressed the one gentleman. I'm just going to call him Pop for the sake of this video. Why Pop? Because as the story unfolds, you're going to see that there's three of these guys that I'm busy witnessing to, and I'm just going to call them Snap, Crackle, and Pop. For the sake of anonymity. And I actually hope that they all get saved and get to watch this video one day so we can have a good laugh about it. But I'm just going to call this particular gentleman Pop because he's the oldest of the four of us. So I said, "Hey Pop, how's it going?" And he blurted out, "Terrible, I'm getting divorced." And I could see from the look in his eye and from the look on the other guy's face, I could tell he's not joking. This is a very tender, serious time in his life. And so I then wanted to kind of help in whatever way I could with this guy. And my natural inclination is jump straight to Jesus, get to Jesus. Okay. But obviously I'm in shock. And what happened was the guy standing next to him, although a very successful businessman, I mean, emotionally, he just took a huge disliking to the potential of where this conversation was going, and he just basically turned around and left. He just excused himself, which left me and Pop there to speak with one another. Now, I've said to you, I just want to jump to Jesus. Now, you got to understand, this is, my background is in like hardcore evangelism. And so what's going through my mind now is Pop needs the gospel. He needs to know about Jesus. He needs to call on Jesus. He needs to reconcile with God through Jesus. He needs to start praying to God in the name of Jesus. He needs to start reading the gospels and following the example of Jesus. He needs to trust in Jesus. This is what I'm thinking. But I'm standing there, and now I'm now going to start talking to him. And as I'm about to launch into my Jesus speech, we got interrupted. And something happened, and someone else was then talking to him, and someone else talking to me, and we got kind of interrupted. And then maybe the bell went, and we had to go and start cooking. Anyway, later on in the evening, I was so frustrated by this. I got speaking to another one of the dads at the school who I know is a committed believer, and his name's Thomas. And I said to him, "Tom, I can't believe this. Pop just blurted out he's getting divorced, and I was about to start witnessing to him and tell him the gospel, and then we got interrupted, and it was like my moment, and I'm so irritated." And Thomas looked at me as if I was a complete moron, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, he said this, "Just take him out for breakfast, bro." And now, I know that you hear that and you may think to yourself, well, I mean, that's like obvious. But you got to understand, in my mind and in my head and the way that I'm built, it's like the creativity of that suggestion completely floored me. It was like wisdom from heaven, which I would never have thought of myself. And I thought to myself, that's brilliant, Tom. You know, I don't have to do it all right here tonight. So, you know, what a thought. So, taking Tom's approach, the next morning, I dialed it down a bit, dropped it a few gears, and so I gave Pop a call. Sorry, I had to edit the video because I said his real name there. I gave Pop a call, and I said, Pop, Steve Johnston here. You know, sorry, I'm so sorry to hear what I heard from you last night about the divorce, and I'm sorry I didn't get more time to chat to you, but let's have breakfast. We'd love to talk to you more about this. And he was delighted. He said, that's amazing. Thanks so much for reaching out to me. We had breakfast. At that breakfast, in fact, he did ask some questions. I got to share some of my thoughts around purpose in life and faith and how I got to tell him a bit of my own story. But something had changed in my heart and mind through my friend Thomas. And I'm going to tell you, this is now a couple of years later now. And I've never unlearned the lesson that I learned that night. It did permanently do something in me that it taught me a lesson about being patient in my witnessing to those who are around us in kind of a close community. It's okay to take a longer term approach and to build friendship and to earn trust. Now, this is exactly what I began to do with Pop. We began having breakfast together once a month. Now, at about the same time as that, there was another one of the fathers whom I got into a discussion with because our daughters are close friends, and we'd had some challenging times with our teenage girls, as those of you who got teenage girls know that you do have, and we'd been talking as dad saying, you know, we really need to keep in touch with each other more as fathers. We need to kind of know where our girls are going. We need to, if we're not comfortable about something, we need to be telling each other what's happening, and we need to be kind of boxing smart together as dads. And I'd said to him, well, let's have dinner. He had another friend that he wanted to include in that dinner, who was also a father of a daughter in my eldest daughter's year. And then I thought, well, Pop also has daughters in, actually both of my daughters' years at school. Let me invite him to come along to that dinner as well. So what happened was the four of us then met for dinner one night. And we were ostensibly there to talk about our daughters and raising teenagers and what to do about it. Now, all three of these guys are unsaved. And there I am, an evangelist, sitting with three unsaved guys at a dinner, and actually, you know what, having an amazing time with them. One of the things I've learned through this process is that unbelievers can be the most amazing friends. They can have incredibly creative ideas. They can teach me a lot. They can help me see things through new eyes. Now, I mean, you know all that. Okay, but for me, it's been a revelation. So what has happened is we've then started a dinner club, and very quickly we began making closer and closer friendships to the point now we've been meeting for 2 years where we are now really tight, the four of us. They all know I'm a Christian. In fact, when we have dinner together, they're drinking the whiskey, they're going for it, they're topping up the wine, and I'm perfectly comfortable with it, and I'm laughing with them and enjoying it. I just manage my own behavior. I have my own boundaries, and they know that and they respect that about me. In fact, they ask me now to say grace when we have dinner. Stephen, could you say grace? And I bow my head and I pray a heartfelt prayer in the name of Jesus. Now, one of the other things I've done over the last 2 years is I've begun meeting with all three of these guys one-on-one between our monthly dinners, and we have breakfast together, and all three of them have confided in me, asked me my story. I have preached the gospel to all three of them. On top of that, as I've been teaching you in one of the other sessions, I then invited these three guys and their partners to attend the Can We Know God course with me. And two of them said yes. The other guy we're still working on, they came to the Can We Know God course, loved it. Why? Because they came knowing that I love them, that I'm interested in their lives, that I genuinely care for them, and so they were open. We had a couple of other Christian families in that group. It was an incredible time. Opened up lots of conversation. Now, what that has done is for these guys, I can talk to Snap, Crackle, or Pop about anything spiritual that I want to. I've got permission now, and I can invite them to things, and I'm beginning to work more and more on the witness. So I've given one of them a couple of books. I've invited them to other events, etc. We're working on them, and I am praying for them every day in my little prayer list, which sits on my coffee table. Okay, so we're going to get into this four-step witnessing strategy in our next session. But one of the points I'm wanting to make to you with my story is that before you can begin implementing this come and see strategy with anyone, you've got to have specific people in mind that you're going to do it with. So in the story that we read from John chapter 1, after spending the day with Jesus, Andrew determined in his mind, I am going to speak to Peter about this. And he went and did so. And similarly with Philip, after Jesus called Philip to follow him, he determined in his mind, I am going to tell my friend Nathaniel about Jesus, and I'm going to tell Nathaniel to come and see. Now, we've got to do the same. We've got to have specific people in mind. And so, the first thing we're going to do before we get into this next session where I teach you the four-step strategy, the first thing we're going to do now is very practical. You are going to make a list of between 3 and 6 unsaved people or couples with whom you believe that if you just put some time, effort, and focus into it, you could build a better relationship with them. So these will be people with whom there is already some natural affiliation. There's a sense of genuine enjoyment of each other's companies, although you may not know them very well right now, but they are people that you think you could realistically become better friends with if you just put some effort into it. Okay, so this is not about picking the 3 or 6 most impossible, difficult people, and then, you know, going on a mission to get them saved. No, this should not be hard work. These are people that you genuinely could see yourself being better friends with, and the only reason you're not is just because you haven't been deliberate about taking the time to do so. You know, I'm sure there's couples, as there are in our lives, that we've been meaning to have over for dinner for quite some time, but, you know, life is busy and you just never get around to it. Okay, so you're going to stop this video now, and before you start the next session, you are going to make a list. And we're going to call this your come and see list. Your come and see list. And then in the next session, I'm going to teach you what to do with the people on your come and see list. So in your little pack, you'll see that there's a come and see card. And you're going to use that card now to make your list. And then I'll see you in the next video.